Hello everyone, my name is Marke Pule and I'm giving a talk about financial market data in real time in Mathematica in general and about our product Mathematica Link for IQ Feed. We'll show you how you can access historical market data from inside Mathematica and also subscribe to real time information directly from the exchanges.
Good afternoon everyone. My name is Marke Pule and I will speak today about real time financial market data in general, how to get it into Mathematica and about our product, IQ Feed Link, or Mathematica Link for IQ Feed.
Is that okay to just have the full screen off like that? Is that okay?
Sure. So,
just carry on.
Okay. Okay, the presentation will have three parts. The first part, I give a quick overview over the software itself, what the features, how it's being programmed. Second part, the major part, will consist of a live presentation, so I hope everything will turn out right here. And the third part is kind of an outlook, what we do next. Like it's the first step in a whole setup of things we plan. I won't be able to cover every feature in the 30 minutes, but I think, at least my impression, the audience is quite diverse and background-wise, so I think it doesn't make sense to talk about the more specialized features in the software, because they're really finance specific, okay? But I think you will get a good overview of what can be achieved. So let's start with the overview. So what is Mathematica Link for IQ Feed, or for short, IQ Feed Link? It's an add-on for Mathematica that can connect and access financial market data provided by this DTN IQ Feed. It's a market data provider, market data product from a company called Tailwind. So if you are familiar with Reuters or Bloomberg, that's something familiar. The same, not in the same league, but the same functionality. Okay. It utilizes Wolfram's J-Link technology and the IQ Feed API. And if the executive committee gets time to to approve it, it will be available in the second half of 2014. So it's already ready, but we are still tweaking it a little bit, making it compatible with market data link. Okay, and we thought about a price point of about $300. So it will be for sale. I think most of you don't know about IQ Feed. It's a market data link, and what it's not special, but what makes it a good market data link is that it's unfiltered. It provides every tick, so to say, every trade that happens on an exchange, every order book update that happens on an exchange is sent to your desktop, and you can immediately, in real time, see what's happening on an exchange and can, of course, react to it. Okay? So what can happen on an exchange? Trade can happen because an exchange, I mean, it's a place where sellers and buyers of securities or financial derivatives meet. In the press, it gets the impression that sometimes it's a place where gamblers meet, but that's not the original aim of an exchange, of a market. So what can happen? To a seller and a buyer meet, they agree on price and size, then you have a trade execution and you get notified. Other thing, there are lots and lots of orders that are resting where a seller haven't found a buyer. The seller wants a higher price than any current buyer is willing to pay, and so on. So you have what's called nowadays an order book, where all the orders of the individuals are kept, so to say that's the current state of the market. Okay, so these two kind of information are being provided. This IQ Feed product has market data from several US and international exchanges, stock exchanges and derivative exchanges, NYSE, NASDAQ, also the newer ones, direct bets, also from Europe. For example, the Eurex here in Frankfurt is also connected. And it has about 120,000 subscribers, which pay up from $70 per month. So even if you don't know about the product, there's money to be made in market data, because if you multiply it, then you have like 10 million revenue per month times 12 months. So it's above 100 million. So that's, I guess, nearly the size, or it's even larger than Wolfram. Okay, this product alone, and they have multiple ones. Okay, So a quick technical diagram to make you familiar with how it's set up. On the left-hand side, we have the computer of the user, the box. On the right-hand side, we have AccuFeed server farms, which are located in Nebraska, in the United States. And Nebraska is kind of a central location because they receive all the market data from all the individual exchanges and normalize it and then send it to you, okay? You can connect to the server farm via a local client that's called IQ Connect, which runs on Windows, and it provides socket-based connections to third-party applications on your computer. So you can connect to this IQ Connect via TCP/IP sockets and receive the messages from them. That's what our Java program does. And the Java program connects to IQ feed link, the Mathematica package via JLink. Okay, so we pass the messages, I get up, passed to IQ Connect, and then it passes on to the Java side of the program, and then we send it to Mathematica kernel. So the features, I mean, we already talked about it. What do you expect from a market data product? You want to see historical prices, maybe what happened in the past, to kind of fit some model or do some predictive analysis, and you want to get notified of changes that happen right now. Right? If there is a trade happening right now, you want to get immediately notified. That's what we provide, and furthermore, we provide like a callback function. So you can not only dynamically see graphically the order book, for example, or the last trade, but you can define a function that is called whenever an update happens. So whenever a trade is made, execute function X. Whenever the order book changes, execute function Y. Okay, so it can be automatically apply something to the recent data. And we have some utility functions for symbol lookup and for futures and options. So what do you need? You need Mathematica 8 or 9. I think it will also work in 10 and even better with all the new functions available there. You need a subscription to DTN IQ feed, of course, and you need Windows because this IQ Connect runs on Windows only. But we have tried it with macOS and Bootcamp, and it also works there. So you need also works kind of a virtualized Windows environment. So some of you have a finance background, and maybe some of you have already played around a bit with financial data inside Mathematica, and you might wonder why we need something like a QFeed link. I don't want to pinpoint all that is missing, but I want to make clear why we came up with the idea of this add-on, because what is currently available in Mathematica is, of course, to some extent limited. Yeah. There's no such thing as a subscription now in financial data. You can send a query, for example, you are interested, because now you're in Frankfurt, for BMW and the latest trade. And you query and you get back, it's the last trade was done on March 28 at 5:48. Okay, this is New York time, so you can add 6 hours. So it was, yeah, a couple of minutes ago, so to say. But you are not going to be notified whenever a new trade is made automatically. You have to run it again, yeah? And hopefully you get some new information. Then you have delayed data only. That's not a fault of the problem, but that's the licensing of the exchanges. If you want to receive real-time data, then you have to pay extra. Nowadays, the exchanges make at least, I guess, 30%, not of trading fees, but of market data-related products. Okay? So Wolfram can't allow you to see real-time data because then they would have X amount of dollar per user to the exchanges, for example. Okay, then you see that the trade information is also not very detailed. The timestamp is only down to the minute. It's not even down to the second. So there's a lot of things missing in IQ feed link. We have timestamps down to the millisecond. And also the trade information that are available are not so detailed. We have lots of more
information in our product. You see here some properties that you can access via financial data. It looks quite nice, it's about 70, but there's some important stuff missing, like fundamental data and so on. So that's, of course, it's for free, right? And one thing I want to emphasize is, of course, accountability for data quality. If you see that something is weird, who do you call, right? Do you call Wolfram? Maybe, and they maybe forward your request to the market data provider, but I think nothing will happen, okay? I mean, you have to pay for something if you want quality, and that's why. It's nice, I think, to play around, to get some feel for what is available, what can be done, but if you're in a production environment, you want to have a phone number that you call when something goes wrong. Okay, so that's the introduction, and let's start with the live presentation. Okay, we load the package, and we connect to the feed via with the command market data connect. If you're familiar with Bloomberg Link, it's the same syntax. We try to be as close as possible to Bloomberg Link to make it easier. And then we can connect. Here, this little IQ connect pops up. I have to authenticate myself, and then I get a market data source object back. The main option here is the refresh interval. At first, we thought about sending every new information to the Mathematica kernel. But you can subscribe not to only one symbol, but maybe to 500 or even 2,000, and there can be a lot of messages. When I tried to subscribe to all symbols from the S&P 500 index, so the 500 most actively traded stocks, I had some message rates at peak times of like 50,000 per second. Okay, so, and you don't want to call 50,000 times a second into the Mathematica kernel because you want to do something with the data there. Okay, it's not only about getting the data in, but to do something with the data as well. So we implemented kind of a pulsed version where we store some of the data on the Java side and only dial into Mathematica every 200 milliseconds, for example, or every 100 milliseconds, or every 40 milliseconds, okay? It's nearly real time, but yeah, there's some delay. There's also a nice IQ feed latency, so we can see. This feed provides a heartbeat with a timestamp. So there's a timestamp in Nebraska sent over here, and then whenever they arrive here, I take the time and then I calculate the difference, and so we see we are about 140, 60, 70 milliseconds behind. Physical distances, it may be 8,000 kilometers, so it should be about 40 milliseconds, but it should take the signal to travel in fiber, optic cable. So of course, there are lots and lots of routers in between the steps, that's why it adds up. But I think it's quite good for the product, so 150 milliseconds. Okay. We are connected. First thing you have to know, you have to have the ticker symbol for the stock you are interested. But it changes from vendor to vendor. So we provide a lookup function to search for stocks. Maybe you're interested in Facebook. So you do lookup Facebook, we search by description, and then we hopefully get a list of everything that has the name Facebook in its description. We get two entries. One, we have a ticker symbol FB, it's a listed market ID 21 and a security type 1. So it's a little bit cryptic, but you can get a list of security types that are provided here. So you see one is an equity, so that's stock, so that should be it. And the listed market ID 21, it's a NASDAQ, a global select market, so that should be it. Okay, so we know if we want to get information about Facebook, use the symbol FB. Can also query for futures, for example, here in Germany, because we use it later, because there's now some activity. Look up for Bund futures contract on Eurex, search by description, and we can filter by security type 8, that's a futures contract. Okay, and we get a list of all currently traded
futures contract that expires from June until December. And we can, for example, extract the symbols like this. Here is first. So you have the symbols for the securities or futures you're interested in. So one nice thing you can do, I mean, you want to retrieve somehow also historical data, right? To fit a model, for example, to do a plot, to calculate some probability distributions, and so on. So here we can retrieve tick data from history. Okay, it provides tick data, every trade that has happened is a line. It's not like daily data where you compress a whole day of activity into one line with an open, high, low, close information, the volume, but you see every trade. For example, we are interested in the last 10 trades of Facebook. Okay, so you have a timestamp here on the left, down to the millisecond. You have a price, you have a volume, you have a cumulative volume where you sum up all the volume until that point, and you have bid and ask information, so you can infer, for example, the trade direction. Here it's quite bad, it's inside the market, but here it's a trade at $63.52, and the bid was 63.52, the bid was 63.41. So someone was willing to buy it for 63.41, someone was willing to sell it for 63.52, so you bought it. So the guy who sent the order that was executed was on the buy side, right? He bought it. And we get the information about the exchange on which the trade happened, and we get also trade conditions. So 11 is NASDAQ, and there's is ARCA. And the trade condition, for example, 70 would be a form T trade, means it's outside of the regular trading hours. Right now the trading starts at 9:30, so we are 6 hours ahead. So they are still sleeping there, right? It was 4 o'clock when John had his presentation. Okay, and for example, we can look for all trades that happened in the first second of regular trading in Microsoft. Yeah, these are all the trades that happened in the first second of trading on all the exchanges in Microsoft, because nowadays, you know, regulation NMS, they have like 13 stock exchanges that trade the more familiar stocks, so you've got lots of activity there. But of course, tick data is very difficult to handle, right? The intervals are not regular, and some timestamps are even the same, right? You have here two trades that happened in the same millisecond. So yeah, it's complicated to deal with, and that's why maybe you're interested in bar data only, where you maybe query for the last 5 1-minute interval data, where they compress everything that happened in a minute into one line. Or we can query for hourly data, maybe for the Bund futures contract on Eurex, and you can use the inboard trading chart, for example, to plot that. So you can see a plot of the daily activity in the Bund futures contract by hour of the day. Okay, and you can also have query like weekly or monthly data, for example, the last 5 months the data points for Coca-Cola. So we get monthly data points. Month-end points, maybe for some longer-time models like co-integration models, you are more interested in longer-term relationships, their monthly or weekly data could be interesting. But of course, the most important thing is the subscription to real-time data. Then we have the function market data subscribe. This is a symbol for the Bund futures contract June that trades on the Eurex. I showed that because we have some activity there now. So we subscribe, and if it's done correctly, we get a market data subscription object back. The function also checks if the symbol is available, so I've made up some symbol here, and let's try to subscribe to it too. then it failed because it checks whether the symbol exists. Okay. We can subscribe to several symbols at once. So next to the Bund futures contract, we chose here the DAX futures, the German stock index future contract. And then we simply get a message that we already subscribed to the DAX future, so the Bund futures contract, but we get both subscription object back. Okay, and we can start the subscription. And when we start the subscription, we start receiving data. So now you are in a position to query for market data. Okay, we have two functions there. Snapshot gives you a snapshot of the current state of the market, like the order book. So you see there are some changes, right? We have the symbol that shouldn't change. We have the last price. We have bid size, ask size, for example. But we have also a tick ID or last time the trade was made and so on. And because it's above more than 100 functions, you can, of course, query only for some properties. Maybe you are interested in only the top of the order book. Okay? So bid size, bid, ask price, and ask size. Okay, so you see that there are changes here, for example. So you really get notified real time about the change in the market for these products. And you also get a list of trades that happened since you subscribed. So I subscribed maybe half a minute ago. So these are already all the trades that happened in the Bund futures contract. And this way you could see maybe the last trade that is dynamically updated. Okay. And of course also for the DAX futures contract. And then you see here the exchange is 68, which is Eurex here in Frankfurt, and the trade condition is one, which is a normal trade. Okay, so now you're getting all this information, and what we have implemented is we have this option which called a storage limit. So if the storage limit is exceeded, so here we store 1,000 trades. If the storage limit is exceeded, they delete the oldest one. So you keep your 1,000 trades in that list. So the system doesn't blow up somewhere. Yeah, we have also head file integrated already. So you see how to use a symbol and more detailed information about the options and stuff. So there's only one thing missing, that's the callback. And we have two types of callbacks. One is for the order book changes, that we call a snapshot callback. And let's assume we're interested in some kind of order book imbalance. This time I only subtract the ask size, so the minus in bid size. So, and you can maybe have some simple model where you say if more people are willing to buy the stock, then the price is going up, for example. Yeah. So we define this function, OBI, order book imbalance, and we set the callback function for the subscription 0, which is the Bund futures to that function. So we add the callback, and then this data construct own data should be updated whenever a snapshot update happens. So it can be removed as well. But more interesting is maybe something like average trade duration. Whenever a trade is happening, you calculate the time between the last 10 trades, for example, and you see some kind of activity, right? If the timing is very far away, then maybe there's nothing happening, so you can't execute a large trade, for example. So we simply calculate the average distance between two trades with this function. We add it to the Bund futures and the DAX futures contracts. And we see So here it's about 1.7 seconds, and here it's 5.3 seconds. And this one is updated whenever a trade occurs, okay, whenever trades are sent to Mathematica. So what would be the ultimate aim, and I have three more minutes, is of course that you don't stop here, right? You don't stop just by simply looking at the information. You want Mathematica to automatically react to it. You specify some conditions which you assume should lead to a good trade, and whenever that state is achieved, you automatically send an order to the exchange and try to execute that trade. And that is what we are doing right now. Unfortunately, I can't show you anything, but also 30 minutes would be not too much. That's why I only have this quick outlook. So we understand IQ Fiedling as a first step in what we think as an algorithmic trading platform implemented in Mathematica. Now you have the ability to get the data, historical data, and real-time market data into it. You can add your what's called secret source, your market data, so algorithm, react to that, and that what's simply needed is send the order, right? And that's why we have looked for one of the largest brokers. It's called an Interactive Brokers. It's a global operation, has 200,000 clients, and it has a nice API which you could use using Java or C# something to connect to it and to query for account information, send orders, get execution reports and stuff. So that's the current product we are working on, and hopefully it will also be finished in 2014. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.